What's up, Sen Squad? Welcome back to another Brawl Stars video. Today we're going to be comparing Spike's two star powers, Fertilize and Curveball, and look at in what game modes and in what situations you're going to want to use one star power over the other, because Spike has really come into the meta recently. After he got his damage buff, he's been seeing a lot more play, so it's really important to know which star power is going to be better in what situations. That way you can play Spike to the best of your ability. So let's get started by talking about the benefits of each of the star powers individually. So with Curveball, whenever your attack explodes, the spikes are going to curve out in a special path, but this path is going to be consistent every time. So no matter where you throw it, these spikes are always going to pop out in the exact same directions and curve in the exact same way. And I made a video a long time ago when this star power first came out about how much more area these spikes are covering by following this curved path. And Curveball has changed a lot since then, but currently, according to a post by you/frogsareourfriends on Reddit, we know that Curveball is going to increase the total area that the spikes cover by 37%. Now, it doesn't mean that the spikes fly out farther. They still fly out the same total distance. It's just since that they're not taking a straight path to get there, they're going to be covering more distance in that time. So now, how does this 37% more area actually convert into how many more shots you're going to hit on the field? So that basically depends on two things: how good you are at predicting where your shots are going to land, and how good your opponents are at predicting where the spikes are and dodging accordingly. So any given point in time after your attack explodes, the spikes are going to be the same distance apart as they would be if you didn't have the Curveball star power. There are still only six spikes and they're the same size, so even though they're rotating at any given point in time, they will still have the same space in between them. It's just that the extra velocity that they cover makes them cover more area in the same amount of time. So because of this, there's still a fairly wide margin for people to dodge the spikes if they are in the middle of the area that the spikes cover. Obviously, it is going to be smaller, but you still are going to be able to learn to dodge this attack. And actually, I tried to do this myself with my friend What Meta in Brawl Stars. So we did a bunch of spike 1v1s to test out how good you could actually get at dodging these attacks by using Curveball. So I basically just tried to dodge his attacks for as long as possible, and initially he was having a hit rate of about 70-80%. A lot of the shots were hitting, and this is what a lot of people experience. Because the spikes are going in such a weird path, it's extremely hard to predict them just by looking at them, and even though the path is the same every single time, it takes a while to get used to it. But over time, I figured out the best way to dodge these spikes, and eventually, after a certain point, I was able to dodge about half of the attacks that he used. So basically, if you want to dodge a Curveball shot, you have to be positioned in between the start of where the spikes split out and the end of where they split out. You sort of want to be halfway in between the center of the circle of damage that it covers and the edge of that circle. And this is basically the sweet spot, because if you're towards the edge, the spikes are rotating so fast that it's really, really easy to get hit by them no matter which direction you're moving in. And if you're extremely close to the center, then all the spikes are so bunched up that you're basically guaranteed to get hit. But when you're in that middle spot, it gives you just enough room to be able to move along with the spikes and dodge them without them moving so quickly that they're basically guaranteed to hit you. So in addition to being halfway between the center and the edge of the damage circle, you want to make sure you're also moving slightly in a clockwise direction. This is just because the spikes are rotating in a clockwise direction, and so if you move with the spikes, then you're less likely to get hit by them. So basically, whenever someone throws an attack at you, you want to get to that halfway position, and then you want to start moving clockwise. So sometimes this means walking towards the attack, and that seems kind of counterintuitive at first, but if you practice it, you'll realize that this is going to let you dodge Curveball attacks significantly more. And I definitely saw that I was able to really improve my dodging against this Curveball just by playing a few matches in this 1v1 situation. And if I was doing this for a lot more, I could definitely get really consistent with this dodging pattern. So essentially what I'm trying to say is that Curveball definitely can be played around. Because it just covers 37% more area, it's always going to give you a higher hit rate, but the extra advantage that you would normally gain from having the unpredictable pass of the spikes can be almost completely negated. So that way there's only going to be a minimal advantage from this Curveball. But that is assuming your opponent knows how to dodge, and for most people, I can assume they haven't done this practice with Curveball yet, so they're not going to really know how to dodge it. So in pretty much all situations, Curveball is going to get a lot more value than just the fact that it's covering 37% more area. But there is one drawback to Curveball, is that you can't hit around walls from the right side, because all your spikes curve clockwise, and so you can't have them going counterclockwise around the wall. Whereas you can do this with the normal attack, so you lose some versatility by choosing this star power, but overall, your shots are going to be a lot more consistent, especially if your opponent doesn't know how the spikes are going to move. Now moving on to Fertilize, where you regain 800 health per second if you're standing in the range of your super. So this is just going to help you stay alive. A lot of times you're going to use it at close range, that way you can output a lot of damage because you're going to guarantee that your shots are going to hit since you can just auto-aim them at close range, and you can just guarantee you're going to stay alive during that. So if you're ever facing up against tanks, specifically melee tanks, you just have a massive amount of burst damage, and you're going to be able to walk away alive because of that massive amount of healing that you're getting during the encounter. And even if it's not at close range, you still can use it in a pinch to just quickly heal yourself to full health. This is really good when laning, for example, against another spike. Even if they have curveball and are chipping you down a lot right before you're about to die, you can just throw down your super and then charge back up to full health, all while still shooting, because you don't have to stop shooting to start healing with your super. And this star power doesn't really come with any drawbacks. If you use it optimally, it's always going to be of benefit to you, because worst comes to worst, you can just use your super normally how you would without any star power whatsoever, and use that to slow down your opponent. But if there's any situation in which the healing would help you, then using that is only going to benefit you. So there's no drawback like curveball has. And now if we want to compare these, we sort of just have to see the situations in which one is going to provide more benefit than the other. So fertilize is really going to benefit you when there's a lot of tanks, because you have a massive amount of burst damage potential by slowing them down with the super and healing on top of that. But specifically, how much damage more can you do with fertilize than curveball? So the way I wanted to measure this was basically the fact that you can get 3 guaranteed shots on someone when they're stuck on your super and slowed down. And that's extremely easy to do with fertilize, because you can just walk close to anyone and get away with it, whereas you can't do that with curveball. So just 2 shots, as well as the ticks from your super damage, let you do 4,256 damage. So anyone above that is going to die to those 3 shots that I said you're going to be able to get from using this fertilized star power. And 21 brawlers in the game are above that health mark. So there are going to be a ton of situations where fertilize is going to get you a kill that you might not have been able to get otherwise just by chipping them down with curveball. But all these brawlers that are sort of at like 4,000 health, while you can go super aggressive and guarantee a kill on them, you could also just stay back and guarantee a kill on them by chipping them down a lot more consistently. So we just consider the tankiest brawlers in the game. I'm talking above 6,000 health. There are 9 brawlers in the game that meet this criteria. Fertilize is 100% going to be able to shred these and is going to have a huge advantage against them. Whereas with curveball, even if you chip them a lot, you're really never going to be able to take them down without playing a bit more aggressive, which a lot of times is way too risky if you don't have fertilize. So I calculated the total use rate of these 9 brawlers in every single mode to basically see how often you're going to be in a position where you want to use fertilize as opposed to using curveball. Now I will point out that these use rates are for all trophy ranges above 600. So if we're talking about really high level competitive gameplay that's like 1,000 trophies and above, the meta is actually going to be completely different. Right now, there are a ton of low health brawlers being used. We're kind of shifting away from the tank meta, so fertilize becomes less and less effective as the meta sort of shifts more towards that style of play. But these percentages are more applying to the majority of players, the 99.99% who aren't above 1,000 trophies. So the tank rate is probably going to be significantly lower above 1,000 trophies for these modes, so just keep that in mind. So Bounty is the lowest of these, with only a 6.08% use rate for all of these 9 brawlers combined. There are very few tanks being used in Bounty right now, so it's not going to be very favorable if you use Fertilize there. Then the next highest is Gem Grab, with a 14.54% use rate of tanks, followed by Siege, which has an 18.1% total use rate of these tanks. Then Brawl Ball has a 22.6% use rate, Heist has a 23.15% use rate, Hot Zone has a 23.4% use rate, and finally Showdown has a 25.64% use rate of these tanks. And just for reference, so you sort of understand what these percentages mean, if in a given mode there are about 20% of people that are using tanks, that means about every 2 games you are going to face a brawler that is a tank with 6,000 plus health. So basically, this is a sort of good cutoff point, because if you're facing a tank every 2 games, that means every 2 games, Fertilize is going to be insanely useful and is going to give you a really, really favorable matchup. So since almost all these modes have above a 20% tank use rate, then in those situations, you're definitely gonna want to run Fertilize. Now I want to take a quick moment to talk about Mortis, because Mortis sort of throws all these numbers completely off, because he's not necessarily a tank, but Spike still has a much more favorable matchup against him if he has the Fertilize star power as opposed to the curveball star power. Because if you just throw your super directly on top of yourself, Mortis is going to come in, be slowed down, and you're going to have that extra 800 healing, which is going to completely change the interactions. Mortis can't kill you in 3 shots if you have that one tick of 800 healing, and he can't kill you with 2 shots and a gadget or 2 shots and a super. All those interactions are changed if you have the fertilized star power. And even just forcing him to reload 1 attack is enough for you to completely kill him by unloading 3 of your attacks directly on top of him, because you just deal an insane amount of damage. So fertilize really swings the Mortis matchup. And because Mortis is played so much in so many different modes, we definitely have have to take his use rate into account to determine which modes we're gonna play Fertilize in. So in Bouncy, 9.57% of Brawlers are going to be Mortis. So this is well over the combined use rate of all 9 tanks in Bouncy. So this is going to bring the total use rate of tanks plus Mortis in Bouncy all the way up to 15.65%. And in Gem Grab, the Mortis use rate is about 9.53%, so that's gonna bring the total use rate up to just about 24%. And so now Gem Grab has crossed that arbitrary 20% threshold where you're gonna start facing these favorable Brawlers a lot more often. In Heist and Siege, basically no one uses Mortis, so we won't factor that in, but in Brawl Ball, 17.57% of all Brawlers are Mortis. So that's gonna ramp up the Brawl Ball percentage to over 40% of Brawlers being either a tank or Mortis, which is insane. So Brawl Ball, you can already see that Fertilize is 100% going to be the play at this trophy range below 1,000 trophies. In Hot Zone, he has a 5% use rate, so that's gonna bump it up to 28.4% total use rate. And in Showdown, Mortis has a 6.25% use rate, so that's gonna bump it up to 32%. So essentially this means every single mode other than Bouncy and Siege are going to have a higher than 20% use rate for tanks and Mortis, meaning your opponents are going to play a tank or a Mortis more than every other game, which is really good to hear. And on top of that, in Siege, Fertilize is just really, really good for defense, because if you throw it down on top of the robot and your opponents aren't there to kill you, you can unload your gadget and 3 attacks for an insane amount of damage on the Siege bot without dying. So because of that, and the already close to 20% use rate of tanks, I would argue that Fertilize is also the best star power in Siege for this specific trophy range. So just wrap it up, overall, Curveball is going to make long-range chipping extremely consistent if the opponent doesn't really know how to dodge it, and it's still going to make it at least a bit more consistent if they do know what they're doing. But the thing is, the majority of people don't know what they're doing, so overall, it's going to make your chip damage a lot more consistent. The only thing is, it has the downside of not really being able to hit around the right side of walls, and it's sort of unpredictable for you using it. You also have to get good with predicting where the spikes are going. Then, Fertilize lets you play a lot more aggressive as Spike and get a lot more kills in those 1v1 situations, and it can help 1v1s at long range too, but it does waste your super, so you can't really use it to support your team in that situation. But when you are playing a lot more aggressive as Spike, it's not as good at those really high trophies, because a lot of times you can get punished for playing way too aggressive, and the games are a lot slower and drawn out, with chip damage building up over time. So Fertilize isn't always better at those high trophy situations. But the thing is, Fertilize will always benefit you no matter what, and it doesn't have those downsides that Curveball has. So in the current meta, when we have a lot of squishy Brawlers at those high trophy ranges, at that specific range, you're going to want to play Curveball in Bounty, Gem Grab, Brawl Ball, and maybe Siege. It's about even there, depending on what the rest of your team comp looks like and how aggressive you want to play your Spike. But once again, this is only because there are so many squishy Brawlers. If there were a lot more tanks, then Curveball would just never be used in these modes. And then in Hot Zone, it's also about even. It depends on your team comp. But then in Heist and Showdown, Fertilize is just going to be better because there are so many tanks in Showdown. You have Pam, you have 8-Bit, you have Leons who just come attack you out of nowhere. Fertilize is super good for that. And in Heist, the safe is just one giant tank, and there are also a lot of really meta tanks being played in Heist generally. So below that 1000 trophy mark, basically everyone else, you really only want to use Curveball in Bounty. And even then, Fertilizer is also a really, really good star power, and I could even see an argument for using Fertilizer over Curveball. They're about even. But everywhere else, Fertilizer is definitely the play, because tanks are still used. People are trying to push all of their Brawlers up to a certain trophy mark. They're not spending the time on only the most meta Brawlers and pushing them up to a really high trophy range. And on top of that, Mortis is just used so much that he completely makes a lot of matchups really favorable for Spike. So essentially, in pretty much every situation, Fertilizer is going to be better for the general population at high trophies. Curveball is better in more modes, but only because of the current meta and the current situation. But that's gonna wrap it up for this video, guys. Hope you enjoyed. Don't forget to join the Sand Squad by subscribing, turning on notifications, and making sure your notifications are enabled in settings as well. And that's all for today, guys, so see you later.